Hey there. Thank you so much for stopping by to hang out with me for a few minutes today. And since I know a lot of people don't care about my intros and why I'm making a video, I'm going to try to have timestamps available to skip to the meat of the video if you want to do that. But before you go and skip ahead, it's important to know that this will be a video series. We're not going to get all the way through this configuration in a single video, and I really feel like it'll be more consumable and easier to follow if we break this into a few smaller videos rather than a single really long video. This video is sponsored by eWin Racing and their Flash XL size upgraded ergonomic gaming and office chair. This is a big chair that has all of the creature comforts you would expect from a quality product. The Flash XL features Brissa Ultra PU leather for its breathable performance fabric and proprietary ventilation system to keep you from getting all hot and sweaty while you're doing everything from fragging bad guys in your favorite game to scouring the internet for your next new thing to test out in your home lab. It also comes with memory foam, headrest, and lumbar pillows for maximum comfort. And the headrest is magnetic, so you can set it where you want without those bothersome straps getting in the way and complicating things. The armrests are attached with magnets for easy replacements if you ever need to do that, and they're adjustable in multiple directions, so you can dial in the chair to get the most out of your ergonomic setup. As the name implies, this is the XL, and it's meant for chair enthusiasts ranging from 5'7" to 7 feet tall, and supports up to 550 pounds. To fully dial in the comfort of the Flash XL, there are two different lumbar knobs that allow you to adjust the 4D lumbar support to fit your unique body shape. The seat and the back are firm, but not hard, so you can sit for long periods of time without worrying about your butt and legs falling asleep while you're getting the support that your body needs. Be sure to check out the link in the video description to get more information and a discount code to pick up an eWin Racing chair for yourself and save some cash in the process. That said, let's talk about my relationship with OpenMediaVault for a quick minute, and then we'll get into installing OpenMediaVault 7 and doing some basic configuration. So I actually started my self-hosting journey using OpenMediaVault 4, but that was short-lived since I only had it up for a few days before I found out that OpenMediaVault 4 was at end of life, and then I switched to OpenMediaVault 5. And it was OpenMediaVault 5 where I actually started making content on YouTube about Docker, and in fact, I've got around 200 videos on Docker that are actually built on top of OpenMediaVault 5. And I guess my point is that I really liked OpenMediaVault 5 quite a bit, and it has a bit of sentimental value to me because it's how I got into self-hosting. Then OpenMediaVault 5 EOL'd and OpenMediaVault 6 came out. Honestly, I hated OpenMediaVault 6. The setup process was so different from OpenMediaVault 5, and there were just things that didn't make sense to me. And one of my biggest frustrations with OpenMediaVault 6, besides the initial setup, was that the dashboard setup configuration was stored in the browser storage. So anytime you logged into your OpenMediaVault 6 from a different browser, the dashboard that you had set up was gone and you had to configure it in the new browser. I even went so far as to make a video where I complained about OpenMediaVault 6 and their setup process back in June of 2023 and showed people how to get through the setup process. So in this video, I want to go through the setup process of OpenMediaVault 7 and talk about some of the things I think they fixed or made better from OpenMediaVault 6. So there are a few things that you're going to need in order to get OpenMediaVault 7 set up. First, you're going to need an OpenMediaVault 7 ISO for the installation process. You're also going to need some hardware, and this could be a dedicated computer with a mouse and keyboard and all of that, or it could be a virtual machine. Now, for the sake of this tutorial and this video series, I'm going to be doing this in a virtual machine in Proxmox, but you can do this however makes the most sense to you. Also, you're going to need some time and some patience, and we'll cover why here in a little bit. So as I mentioned, I'm going to be using a virtual machine for this in Proxmox, but I'm not going to get into hard drive pass-throughs and that sort of thing, as it really is outside the scope of this particular video and series. So to get started, like I mentioned, we're going to need to download the OMV ISO from the OpenMediaVault website. So we'll go to openmediavault.org, and then we'll click the download link at the top of the page. There are a couple of different options on that page for downloads, but I would just select the stable version and probably not the old stable version. At this point, you'll get redirected to a third-party site and your download should automatically start. The time it takes for the download to complete will depend on a number of factors, but after a moment or two, you should have an OpenMediaVault ISO in your downloads folder. Again, as I mentioned, I'm going to be doing this in a virtual machine, machine, so I don't necessarily need to create bootable media for this. But if you're using a dedicated piece of hardware, you'll need to get a USB drive for the installation media. And I really think anything larger than a 4 gig USB drive should be sufficient. Next, you'll need an app to set up the bootable media with the USB drive and the ISO that we downloaded. I like to use Balina Etcher for this kind of stuff, but you can use whatever works for you. You'll just plug the USB drive into your PC, the one that you're watching this on, likely, if you're not using a phone or a tablet. And then you'll select the ISO that you downloaded a moment ago and the USB drive in the app and click Create. After a few moments, your USB drive should be ready to go. If you're using dedicated hardware for this installation, you'll need to plug the USB drive into a compatible slot on your what will be your OMV server here in a bit. You want to plug your USB stick into a compatible USB drive and then power on the computer. Then you're going to start tapping the key on your keyboard that will get you into the computer's BIOS or UEFI. And now each computer is going to be different, so be sure to figure out which key it is before you start this step. You can probably find that information online somewhere. Once you've gotten into your BIOS or UEFI, you'll want to go to the boot page and set the USB as the primary boot device, and then the hard drive that's going to be your installation drive as the second boot option. Then you can just save and exit, and the PC should reboot, and then you should see the install script kick up with a blue screen. Now, at this point, we're going to talk about setting up the virtual machine, so feel free to use the timestamps to skip to the next relevant step for you. Now, if you want to use a Proxmox or other hypervisor VM for this, we'll need to make sure that we have the OMV ISO on your hypervisor host system. And there are a couple of different ways we can do this. Method one is just to download the ISO from the website to your computer and then upload it to your hypervisor, in my case, Proxmox, manually. The other option is to get the OpenMediaVault ISO URL and put that into, again, Proxmox to download it directly. For me, that took a really long time for some reason, so pick and choose whichever method works best for you. Once you have the ISO uploaded to your hypervisor, you can now create the VM. And to do that, we're going to click the Create VM button at the top right of the page. And the new screen that pops up will allow us to choose the node we want to install our VM on. I've just got the single node, so I'm not going to change that. The VM ID is automatically set, but you can change that if you want or need to for your own purposes, whatever they happen to be. So I'm also going to give the VM a name. That's one thing you do have to do on this page, and I'm just going to call it OMV7 Tut. Now, we can either click the blue Next button, or we can click the OS tab across the top. I'm just going to click the tabs across the top of this screen to get to each of the next sections. So now I'll select the OMV7 ISO image that we'd added to our server and leave everything else on the page as it is and click System. I apologize, there's stuff going on at the facility behind me here. Now, there's nothing I really need to change on the systems page, but you can make changes specific to your needs and then move on to the disks tab. Now, on the disks tab, you'll want to create a boot drive and a storage drive to fit your needs. With a VM though, you can always go back and adjust these later as long as you have enough resources available on your host system. The only other thing I change on here is the bus/device option from SCSI to SATA. And you might also want to change the cache settings, but make sure you do some research to find the best setting again for your specific setup needs here. Once you have the necessary drives created, you can move on to the CPU tab. You can set how many cores you want to use and then move on to the memory tab. And here we'll set how much memory we want our VM to have. Just make sure that you leave enough resources for your host system, as well as any other systems you might have installed on your hypervisor. On the network tab, I just like to leave this or set this to VMBRO, but you can change this if you have a specific need for your network setup. Next, we'll click the Confirm tab to review our settings, and then you can check the Start After Created checkbox, but I've had weird issues with that in the past, so I'm just going to leave that unchecked. I'll click Finish, and then I'll manually start it later. Now, we're going to look for the OMV7 Tut VM, or whatever you named yours, and click it. Then we're going to click the console, and then click Start Now. After a moment, you should see the OMV screen pop up. So, now that we're all on the same page with our setup, we can click the install option. And most of the next few screens will just involve us clicking enter on our keyboard so that we get the right setting for our location, that sort of thing. After a few of those pages though, you'll get to a screen where you'll be asked to pick a host name for your setup. And by default, it's OpenMediaVault, but again, I'm gonna switch this to OMV7 Tut and click continue. Next, you will select the domain name. Local is by default, and that's what I'm going to use. But if you wanted to, I guess you could change that to something else. But this will allow us to access our OpenMediaVault dashboard once the install is complete by going to the browser and typing in http://omv7.local, or we can use the IP address that we'll find out later. Next, you'll be asked to enter your root user password twice for confirmation purposes. Then you'll select your time zone. After that, you'll select the disk that you want to use for your OpenMediaVault installation. Make sure you select the correct disk for your setup and then hit enter on your keyboard. This process will take a while depending on your setup, so be patient. This is what I was talking about earlier. This may actually take several minutes, again, depending on your setup. The next steps will be to configure the Debian archive servers so that you can do updates and that sort of thing. And again, this process will be region specific, so you'll likely want to choose the locations and options that are nearest to you. Next, you can configure a proxy if you need to for your connection. I've literally never needed to do this, but if you do need to, you can do it right here. Then there'll be a few more minutes of configuration and setup. So again, be patient as this might take a few minutes. After that's complete, you'll be notified that you can remove the boot medium and press enter on your keyboard. If you're using dedicated hardware, you can just remove the USB. If you're using a VM, you'll want to go back to your hypervisor and remove the ISO from the boot order. Once you've done either of these steps, whichever is specific to your setup, you can press enter on your keyboard. This will cause the system to reboot, and then you'll be brought back to a terminal screen, and that terminal has some important information on it. Near the top, you'll see the system's IP address, and below that, you'll see the default username and password for OpenMediaVault. At this point, you can open a browser on whatever machine you're watching this on, and go to either the IP address that was on that terminal screen a moment ago, or you can go to the hostname and domain name that we set up earlier. Again, I used OMV7.local, so if we went to either of those, it would take us to the same place. So once the login screen for OpenMediaVault pops up in your browser, you can use the default login credentials that were on our terminal window just a moment ago. So now that we're logged in, I'm going to close the default welcome screen and then click the link to go to the settings page that's used to set up my homepage dashboard. From here, we can select which widgets we want, or we can select them all with a single click and then click save. The page will then reload and we can see all of the different widgets in action. Now, what I find nice about the dashboard in OpenMediaVault 7 over OpenMediaVault 6 is that these settings now appear to be stored in the operating system configuration rather than in browser storage like they were in OpenMediaVault 6. I can't tell you how happy it made me when I realized that. So if we look to the right of my screen, we can see that there appear to be an update available. So let's go ahead and click on that. And it actually looks like there are several updates available. Now we can scroll down through the page and look at all of those, but then we can scroll back up to the top and click the blue download button at the top of the page. When the updates are complete, you should see a close button activate on that little pop-up window, and the scrolling virtual terminal window should say something like end of line. Or as we see in this case, it says connection lost. So go ahead and click the close button there and then the check mark and the yellow bar at the top and then click confirm. Now, if we click the reload button at the top right, we'll see that all of the updates are complete. If they're not for you, you can just run those updates again and kind of knock those out as required for your setup. So this part is actually, I think, one of the most important things you can do for this setup immediately. And that's go to the top of the page where you see the little person icon, click that, and then click change password. This is for the admin user account to access OpenMediaVault 7. This will not change the root password that we set up during the installation process. Enter your new password in both text fields and click save. So now the default login will be admin and whatever password you just entered. It might actually be a good idea to create a completely different admin user just to remove that from the equation if somebody tries to hack your system. Now, going back up to the user icon at the top, there's an option for dark mode. So let's click that if you're so inclined and we can get our dark mode on here. Now, if we click the bell icon near the top right of the screen, we'll see that there are some updates that may require a reboot to take effect. So let's go ahead and click the power icon to the right of that and then click confirm and the checkbox and then click yes. The system at this point should reboot and our newest updates should be installed during that process. And I think at this point, we're going to wrap up this video. Now, while we haven't really done much with regard to OpenMediaVault itself, we've actually accomplished quite a bit in this video already. And this video is already a bit longer than I wanted it to be. In the next video, we're going to get into some additional user creation, setting up our additional hard drive, and getting some folders set up. And then we'll look at setting up some network shares as well, just in case you just wanted to use this as a NAS. After that, we'll take a look at setting up OpenMediaVault extras, Docker, and more. So I hope that you'll join me in this video series. Of course, if there are any specific requests that you have for this series, please be sure to leave that in the comment section down below. With that said, I want to thank you guys again for spending a few minutes of your day with me today, and I'll talk to you in the next video.